Let's continue this discussion and go off script tonight with D.C. Delegate Eleanor Holmes Norton and Roger Pilon, who is an attorney, director of the Cato Institute Center for Constitutional Studies, and also served in the Reagan administration. Delegate Norton, to you first. You heard Congressman Raskin there say maybe there's a compromise to be worked out combining D.C. and Puerto Rico somehow. Would you agree that the bill as it's written would have no chance in the Senate?
I don't agree to any of that.
Okay.
He also pointed to half dozen bills that are sitting over there that have not been passed yet. So we don't pass legislation in the House saying, well, let's not pass it until we're sure what the Senate is going to do. We understand what Jamie, for example, means when he mentions Puerto Rico. The problem with Puerto Rico, at least at the moment, is that, first of all, they may be entitled to five or six states, and they don't pay any federal income taxes. So sitting over here in day one, trying to figure out what will happen at the end is to keep anything from passing in the House. This is historic. We are going to pass a bill to make the district the 51st state in the House of Representatives. That's never happened before. And guess what? Almost everything that is now pending in the Senate has never happened before. You do your strategies house by house. You do your House strategy. When it gets over to the Senate, you've got to try an entirely different strategy. So the worst thing you can do is to look at how the last state got in and say, well, that's it, folks. That's the only way to get into the union. So nobody knows what he's talking about when he says this can't possibly be done, because if that's the case, then of course that's the case for every pending bill in the Senate today.
Roger, you would agree that this bill has a good chance of passing in the House. What do you think would happen next?
It would go to the Senate and there it would die, because of the political reasons that you spoke of earlier. Namely, there simply is no support out in the country for this kind of thing. Moreover, it would take a constitutional amendment, as most legal scholars agree.
So Congressman Raskin disagreed.
Yeah, well, yes, I know he did. I've debated him more than once. We are very far apart, and I'm not surprised that he takes this position. But it would take a constitutional amendment, because the Constitution is quite clear. The clause in Article 1, Section 8, the Enclaves Clause, provides for the creation of a district no more than 10 miles square for the seat of the U.S. government. And almost contemporaneously with the ratification of the Constitution, Congress passed just such a measure and it was created. Now, the proponents of this say that, well, they said no greater than. Therefore, they want to reduce the size of the U.S. government to a tiny enclave around the National Mall that would include maybe the Supreme Court building, the White House, and so forth, and then turn the rest of the District of Columbia into this new state. And I don't think the American people want to see the nation's capital reduced to such a tiny section of the current District of Columbia.
Now, Delegate Norton, I understand where you're coming from. I'm trying to jump 13 steps down the road and you haven't even passed step one yet. But certainly we all understand the political realities of what it would take to make D.C. the 51st state. Is there anything less that's acceptable than making D.C. the 51st state?
Well, you know, when your district, and most states were districts before, are number one in federal taxes paid to support the government of the United States, it's kind of an insult to say, hey, you people, why not take something less? There are two states that have a population less than ours. There are six states that are about the size of the District of Columbia. The matter of constitutionality has never been litigated. The fact is most states have gotten into the union in the same way we're trying to get into the union, through the Congress of the United States. We've left in place what would be what the Constitution says. It has to be these places in the middle, which are the federal government.
Roger, I want to leave it with you real quick. The last question here. Certainly you would agree that the framers never intended that a population within the United States be disenfranchised from having a vote in the House and Senate.
I'm not sure about that, because they provided for the Constitution for the way they did. Now, whether they thought about it or not, who can say? But the fact is, not only would you have to have an amendment to get this, but you're going to have to amend the Constitution further with respect to the 23rd Amendment, because
which gave D.C. the right to vote in the presidential contest, right?
And that would be easily dealt with, because it would be eradicated, and the states would have to agree to eradicate it.
Well, this is a discussion that is certainly not going away, as you pointed out, Delegate Norton. D.C. has come farther than they have perhaps in the past. We have this hearing coming up on the 24th of July in the Oversight Committee. We'll of course be following it closely. Thank you both so much for coming in to contribute to the discussion.